In the last video, we discussed about difference between metals, semiconductor and insulators. While discussing it, we say that we have a valence band and a conduction band. So this is a valence band below and above which is conduction band, and this is the energy axis. So as I go upward, the energy goes on increasing. So the valence band is completely filled. So this band is completely filled with electrons, and this band is empty. This band is empty. Conduction band is empty, and this is the situation at 0 degree Kelvin. At higher temperature, however, what happens? These electron gets some amount of energy, electron in valence band gain some amount of energy, and they got promoted into conduction band, and now they can move around. So the gist of last lecture is something like this. The first thing is, in order for a conduction, we need free states available. In other words, only electrons in conduction band can move, can conduct. The second thing we discuss is that valence band or semiconductor and insulators is completely filled at 0 degree Kelvin. As the temperature increases, the electron make a transition from valence band to conduction band, and hence there will be some vacancies, and those vacancies are known as hole, and those can also conduct electricity. We are going to discuss about that also. On the basis of this band structure, we say that in case of metals, the valence band and the conduction band, they overlap each other. So this is conduction band, this is valence band, they overlap each other. This is the case for metal or conductors. In case of semiconductors, there is a gap between this top of the conduction band, valence band, and bottom of the conduction band. So there is a gap between this valence band and conduction band, which is known as the band gap of the material, and it is of the order of 1 to, let's say, 5 electron volt. So this is semiconductor. However, in case of metals, the band gap is very, very, very large. It is greater than 5 electron volt. So this is the band gap. And this band gap is large, greater than 5 electron volt. And as here, in case of metals, the electron does not require any additional energy to go into conduction band, and hence they can conduct electricity even at 0 degree Kelvin as well. However, in case of semiconductor, a small amount of energy of the order of 1 to 5 electron volt is required to promote an electron from valence band into conduction band, and hence these are bad conductor of electricity at low temperature and good conductor of electricity at high temperature. However, in case of insulators, this is insulator. Since the band gap is very large, in order to promote electron from this valence band into conduction band, a large amount of energy, greater than 5 electron volt, is needed, and hence they are very bad conductor of electricity even at very high temperature. Now, after discussing this, we are going to discuss about semiconductors. So let's talk about semiconductors now. Generally, the semiconductors are of two types, called as intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. What I mean by intrinsic semiconductor? Intrinsic means these are pure semiconductor. And extrinsic, these are impure or rather doped semiconductor. What I mean by doping, okay, let's discuss about doping for a minute and then we will discuss about intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductor. So doping is a process of intentionally adding controlled amount of impurities. So what is doping? In doping, we add controlled amount of dopings, controlled amount of impurities in a pure semiconductor material. So what is pure semiconductor material? For example, the type semiconductor material that we generally encounter is silicon, germanium. These are the semiconductor that we generally encounter. There are also compound semiconductor, something like ZnSe, CdSe, PbSe, etc. These are compound semiconductor and these are semiconductors. So they all can be pure or they all can be extrinsic. So for the time being, let's consider I am talking about only silicon and germanium. So in case of silicon and germanium, if I take a piece of intrinsic silicon, for example, so this is a piece of intrinsic silicon, then all the atom inside this particular material will be of silicon only. There will be nothing else than silicon. Everything will be silicon. So this will be very pure material. As this is very pure material, it is known as intrinsic semiconductor. On the other hand, in case of extrinsic semiconductor, if I take a piece of extrinsic silicon, for example, then all the atoms will not be of silicon only. There may be some atoms of some other impurities, depending on what kind of impurities I want. So, some impurity atoms are present. So, many a times it is also possible that if I take a intrinsic semiconductor, a material of semiconductor material, if I take a semiconductor material and all the atoms are of the same material or all the molecules that are building this particular material is same. For example, I take silicon. However, there are some defects. For example, some silicon atoms are absent and there is some vacancy created. In such case also, if something like this arises, we also call this as extrinsic semiconductor. So why? We are going to discuss that in a minute. So for that, we need to look at intrinsic and extrinsic semiconductor closely. So let's look at intrinsic semiconductor first. So we are going to discuss about intrinsic semiconductor and I'm going to consider an example of silicon. So if I take an intrinsic silicon semiconductor piece, then microscopically in this semiconductor there will be all silicon atoms and each silicon atom has a valency of 4 and hence it can bound to a neighboring 4 silicon atom. Bond that the silicon is bounded by what is known as tetragonal symmetry. In a tetragonal symmetry, so in a two dimensional I can show it something like this. If this is my silicon, then one silicon is attached over here, another silicon will be attached over here, another silicon will be attached over here, another silicon will be attached over here, and this silicon has, this particular silicon will have 4 electrons valency. So one electron will be over here, another electron will be over here, another electron will be over here, another electron will be over here, and this silicon will add one electron. So this bond is satisfied. Another silicon will add another electron. So this bond will be satisfied. Similarly, the third electron and fourth electron. and these silicons are further attached to another thing, silicons, something like this. So in terms of band diagram, I'm going to have something like this. This will be my conduction band and this will be my valence band. This is valence band and this is conduction band, and there will be a band gap of this particular material, and in case of silicon the band gap is 1.1 electron volt. So this is the structure of silicon. Now suppose, since all these electrons are bound to the respective silicon, so let's look at 0 degree Kelvin. What is going to happen at 0 degree Kelvin? At 0 degree Kelvin, what's going to happen is that these electrons will be bound to this particular silicon atom. All the 4 electrons of this silicon atom will be bound to this silicon atom. All 4 electron of this atom will be bound to this electron. And hence, at 0 degree Kelvin, the electrons are all residing inside valence band. So what you can say, using this particular example, you can say that the electrons in valence band are bound to the atoms. So whatever electrons are there in a valence band, they are bound to the their respective atoms, right? Now suppose I start increasing the temperature. So the temperature is no more 0 degree Kelvin, and I started to increase the temperature. What's going to happen? As I go on increasing the temperature, let's first look at this particular diagram. What's going to happen? This electron can be detached from this particular silicon atom, and it will be over here, and it is free to move around, right? In terms of band diagram, what we say that the electron from valence band goes into conduction band. You are getting my point. Magar yahan pe mujhe kitna energy dena padega to detach this particular electron from silicon atom? I need to provide an amount of energy which is equal to band gap energy. So what is my band gap energy? Band gap energy is amount of energy required to detach a bound electron from a ion. Please note, even though this electron is removed from this particular atom, it is still within the crystal. It is not getting outside of the crystal, so it is not going outside of the material. It is still inside the material and it is moving randomly inside a material. So the band gap energy is the amount of energy required to detach a bound electron from a atom or ion. Now what is going to happen when I detach an electron? So let me redraw this particular diagram and another silicon over here, and this structure goes on up to infinity, and I'm concerned about this particular silicon atom. So 1, 2, 3, and 4, there will be 4 electron, bound electron, and the neighbors will have again the 4 electrons. And now suppose by some mean I provided it with some amount of energy which is equal to greater than 1.1 electron volt, what is going to happen? Because of this particular additional energy, this electron will be detached from here and it will come over here and it can move around. Now as you can see, there will be a creation of vacancy at this particular point because the electron is removed from that particular point. This particular vacancy is known as hole. In terms of band diagram, this is my valence band and this is my conduction band. When electron is removed from here, there will be creation of a vacancy and there will be a creation of electron over here, and this is your hole. Now this electron in conduction band, it can conduct electricity. Similarly, this hole also conduct electricity. So if I apply an electrical potential over here, what's going to happen? Suppose I have applied something like this, positive potential over here and negative potential over here. So this electron will move in this direction, right? This electron, the free electron will move in this direction. However, what again going to happen is that since there is a positive potential in this direction, the electron over here or from here will jump over here and there will be a creation of vacancy. And now suppose there is another silicon atom over here. So next time what is going to happen? This electron will jump over here and there will be a vacancy, right? So as you can see, due to applied potential, if the motion of electron is in this particular direction, the motion of hole will be in opposite direction. I am denoting electron by this symbol and hole by this particular symbol. Right? Why positive? Because since electron has a negative charge, and if I remove electron from this particular place, there will be a positive charge left. Because initially this was neutral, so locally there will be a positive charge. What is going to happen to the whole piece of silicon? Whether this will be positively or negatively charged? As there are equal number of electrons and equal number of protons throughout this as a whole material, this will be neutral. But locally there will be some positive charge and some negative charge. So the electron in conduction band conduct electricity and hole in valence band conduct electricity. So as you can see over here, if I excite an electron from valence band into conduction band, a hole is created over here. Now suppose if what will happen if I excite 1000 electron to the conduction band, there will be 1000 hole created in the valence band. So in case of intrinsic semiconductor, if I need denote Ne by number of electron and Nh by number of hole, then number of electron will be equal to number of hole. This is the actual condition for intrinsic semiconductor. For intrinsic semiconductor, number of electron has to be equal to number of hole. If there is a difference between number of electron and number of hole, then the material is not intrinsic. Even if this particular the composition of the material is very pure, even after that it will not be intrinsic semiconductor if number of electron will not be equal to number of hole. So this is the requirement for intrinsic semiconductor. A material to be called as intrinsic, the number of electron has to be equal to number of hole. Now let's look at extrinsic semiconductor. In extrinsic semiconductor, doping is used, so we intentionally introduce controlled amount of impurities. Why do we add controlled amount of impurity? Because we have some purpose for this. Since we have some purpose, the impurities that we are going to add, they will be very special type of impurities. So what is our purpose? Our purpose is to increase the electrical conductivity. So in order to increase the electrical conductivity, we add some controlled amount of impurities. We can control how much impurities we want to add. And in order to increase this electrical conductivity, we can add two types of impurities. We can add what is known as trivalent impurity, or we can add pentavalent impurity. What is trivalent impurity? Trivalent impurity means the atom will have three valence electron. Pentavalent means the atom will have five valence electron. So let's look at the same silicon example. Suppose I have something like this. This is a silicon bound to four neighboring silicons, and these silicons are also bound to another silicon atom. So this silicon have four valence electrons. So there will be four valence electrons, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now suppose by some means, somehow I remove this particular silicon and I replace it with, let's say, trivalent impurity. what's going to happen? It will be something like this silicon, and there will be some trivalent impurity. Let me call it as X. What is X? I'm going to explain. So X is trivalent impurity, and X is something like boron, which have three valence electrons. So let's say I'm going to replace it by boron. So now what is going to happen? Initially there was four valence electrons, and these are paired with the neighboring silicon atom, something like this. Now over here, what is going to happen? This silicon will have an electron, one electron, one electron, and one electron. However, since this boron have only three electrons, it can bond with three neighboring silicon atoms. So the one electron will be bound over here, another electron will be bound over here, another electron will be bound over here, and this will be an empty space. And what is an empty space? An empty space is a hole. So what we have done over here, we have intentionally added boron and created a hole without exciting an electron, right? So what's going to happen? This is even at 0 degree Kelvin, but we have more number of holes if there is a trivalent impurity, right? Now we usually add very large amount of boron atoms, and the impurities or the amount of hole that is created is of the order of 10 to the power 12. And hence, if you look at the band diagram of this particular material, you will get something like this. This is valence band, this is conduction band. There are no electrons in the conduction band at 0 degree Kelvin we are talking about. So there are no electrons in a conduction band, but there are holes in a valence band. And now if I apply electric field to this particular material, what is going to happen? Under the influence of electric field, these holes can conduct electricity. We have seen over here, right? If electron is moving in this direction under the influence of electric field, the hole will move in this particular direction, and it also conducts electricity. So even at 0 degree Kelvin, we are getting electrical conductivity in this material. So we have improvised electrical conductivity. Right? Now the another impurity, we say that okay, there are two types of impurity to enhance the electrical conductivity: trivalent impurity. So when you add a trivalent impurity, you get holes. What will happen if we add pentavalent impurities? When you add a pentavalent impurity, so let's say I added phosphorus. So this pentavalent impurity will be, there will be 5 valence electrons, and this is bound to 4 neighboring silicon atoms. So initially I have something like this, one silicon atom is bound to four silicon atoms. Then when I replace it, so I have one electron over here, one electron over here, one electron over here, one electron over here. So this silicon atom will have four electrons, and neighboring silicon will add one more electron to this particular, and they will form a covalent bond. Okay, now when I replace this silicon by a pentavalent impurity, what is going to happen? A pentavalent impurity, the structure will remain same, only the atom is replaced, right? So this silicon ka ek atom, this silicon will have one atom, this silicon one atom will be contributed over here, and this phosphorus will have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1. This is fifth electron. So this fifth electron will be bound to this particular atom as well. Okay, so what we have over here? We have an additional electron right? And this electron can easily be detached from this particular atom. So we have extra electrons present here, or extra free electrons is present, right? So a trivalent impurity creates hole. On the other hand, a pentavalent impurity creates electrons, additional electrons and additional holes. Similarly, if you look over here, this hole will be bound to this boron atom, and this electron is bound to this pentavalent impurity. Now let's look at this particular thing. So in terms of band diagram, what's going to happen is that since I am adding an impurity atom, in a band structure, these impurity atoms will introduce their own energy levels. So this is valence band and this is conduction band. And let me say that I have added here a trivalent impurity, and here I have added a pentavalent impurity. So this trivalent impurity will also introduce its own energy level, and it so happens that since this trivalent impurity introduces holes, the impurity level will be very closer to the valence band, and this is known as, since it is accepting electron, it can accept electron from this valence band over here, the electron can jump over here, and then there will be a creation of hole over here, a free hole will be created. Since it is accepting electron, this is known as acceptor energy level, EA. Similarly, the pentavalent will introduce its own energy level, and it, since it is, there is an extra electron and this electron can be easily made free, it is very close to a conduction band, and it is, since it is donating an electron, it is known as donor impurity level, ED. So there is an electron over here, and this electron can easily go into conduction band, and then it can conduct electricity. So what does that mean? Jo maine yahan pe dikhaya hai ki a electron from valence band can go to this acceptor impurity level, and there will be a creation of hole over here, and a electron from donor impurity level can jump into conduction band, and then the electron can conduct. What does that mean in terms of over here? So here, when I have a trivalent impurity, this hole is bound to this particular atom, and in order to transfer an electron from here to here, I need some amount of energy. You're getting my point? So that some amount of energy is the difference between this, the valence band, and the impurity level. This is conduction band. So whatever this small amount difference in energy is the energy required to move this electron from here to here. And when this electron is moved from here to here, there will be a creation of hole at this particular point, and hence in the valence band. Similarly, in case of pentavalent impurities, this electron is bound to this particular atom, and in order to make it free, we need to detach this atom from this particular impurity atom, and there will be, we require some amount of energy to do that particular thing, and hence when we detach this electron, this electron can be freely. So that's what is happening over here. This is my valence band, this is a conduction band, and this is a donor impurity level, and there is an electron in donor impurity level. A small amount of energy will detach this particular electron, and the electron can move free. So in terms of band diagram, I show that the electron goes from donor impurity level into conduction band. And this amount of difference between this donor impurity level and conduction band, and acceptor impurity level and valence band, is very, very small. It is of the order of few milli electron volt. So even our potential will also provide this much amount of energy. So this is a trivalent impurity, and this is the case for trivalent impurity, and this is the case for pentavalent impurity, and these are the band diagrams for these. Please note, since this trivalent impurity is introducing a hole, and we say that the charge of hole is positive, since it has a positive charge, and a pentavalent impurity introduces an electron and it has a negative charge, the trivalent impurity डालने के बाद जो मटेरियल तैयार होगा उसको बोलते हैं पी टाइप सेमीकंडक्टर. और जब पेंटावेलेंट इंप्यूरिटी डालेंगे तो नेगेटिव चार्ज आएगा ज्यादा, मतलब इलेक्ट्रॉन ज्यादा होंगे सो नेगेटिव चार्ज ज्यादा होगा. सो दिस इज नोन एज एन टाइप इंप्यूरिटी. सो लेट्स डिस्कस अ लिटिल फर्दर. नाउ suppose I have this particular n-type material and I have this p-type material. What will be the charge on this n-type material? What is the charge on n-type material and what will be the charge on p-type material? You might say that n-type material is negatively charged, and you might say that p type material is positively charged. Correct? That's what you're going to say, but it's wrong. Both these materials are neutral. How? When I replace a silicon, what I am going to do, so this was my initial structure and I am going to replace this silicon by, let's say, boron. So I am removing 14 electrons from this particular material and I am removing 14 proton, right? And I am adding a neutral atom. So I am adding 3 electrons and 3 protons. So even after replacing and getting something like this, the total number of proton is equal to total number of electrons, and hence this material is neutral. But just like in case of metals there are free electrons, I am going to have a free hole over here in this particular case. In case of pentavalent impurity, I am going to remove 14 electron and 14 proton when I remove a silicon atom, but I am adding 5 electrons and 5 protons. So because of that, again I am going to have a neutral material. So this n-type and p-type material, they are not charged, they are also neutral, but we have free electron and hole in these materials. If that thing is clear, let me ask you a next question. What is the relation between number of electron and number of holes for, let's say, p-type and n-type material? Let's say first let's discuss about p-type material. In case of intrinsic, what we have in case of intrinsic, number of electron will be equal to number of hole. So this is the case. Let's discuss it on the basis of band structure, valence band, conduction band. And when you excite an electron from valence band into conduction band, an electron is in conduction band and there will be a hole in valence band, and because of that there the number of electron will be equal to number of hole. However, over here, before exciting this electron from valence band into conduction band, there is a created hole because of this acceptor impurity. So this electron is transferred over here and hole is created, right? Now, when I excite an electron from valence band into conduction band, what's going to happen? There will be an electron over here and there will be hole over here. So, how many electrons now I have? I have one electron and two holes. So, what is the relation between number of electron and number of hole? The number of hole will be larger than number of electron. And hence, this is not a intrinsic material. This is extrinsic material, because the number of electron is not equal to number of hole. What about n-type material? In n-type material, you add pentavalent impurity, and hence, since you add a pentavalent impurity, you have something like this. This is your valence band, this is your conduction band, right? And you have a donor impurity level, and this donor impurity level add electrons to the conduction band before exciting an electron from valence band, right? Now, when you excite an electron from valence band into conduction band, you have an electron in conduction band and you have a hole created in valence band. Now, how many electrons do we have over here? We have two electrons and hole, one hole. So, what is the relation between number of electron and number of hole? Number of hole will be less than number of electron, right? So, this is the relation between the charges for extrinsic semiconductor material. I hope you understood this particular process. So, by doping a intrinsic semiconductor material, we create an extrinsic semiconductor material, and there are two types of semiconductor, extrinsic semiconductor, n-type and p-type. If you talk about semiconductor material, there are two types of semiconductor, intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. In extrinsic semiconductor, we have n-type material and p-type material. In order to create a n-type material, we add pentavalent impurity. For p-type material, we add trivalent impurity. Then the number of electron and number of hole kya jyada hota hai? Since it is n, the number of electrons are larger. In the case of p-type material, number of electrons will be less than number of hole. Right? And this is neutral material. This is also neutral material. And since the number of electrons are large over here, we say that the majority charge carriers are electron in n-type material, and majority charge carriers are hole in p-type material. And since majority are electron, the minority charge carriers in n-type material will be hole, and in case of p-type material, the minority charge carrier will be electron. And please note, we are not adding one atom or two atom. The impurities are added are of the order of 10 to the power 12. Let's say 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 12. So there will be the number of electron in n-type material will be in excess of 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 12, and number of hole in p-type material will be in excess of 10 to the power 6 to 10 to the power 12. Kitna impurity dala hai utna us wahan pe jyada holes honge as compared to electron. But dono ke dono material neutral hai. Please isko samajh lijiye aap. They are not charged. वहाँ पे फ्री इलेक्ट्रॉन्स अवेलेबल है और फ्री होल्स अवेलेबल है जो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी को कंडक्ट कर सकते हैं। नाउ लेट मी जस्ट इंट्रोड्यूस अनदर कंसेप्ट विच इज नोन एज फर्मी एनर्जी। सो फर्मी एनर्जी इज फॉर इन केस ऑफ मेटल्स, फर्मी एनर्जी इज डिस्क्राइब्ड एज द हाईएस्ट ऑक्यूपाइड एनर्जी लेवल एट 0 डिग्री केल्विन। प्लीज नोट दिस इज द डेफिनेशन ओनली फॉर मेटल्स। सो फर्मी एनर्जी इज हाईएस्ट ऑक्यूपाइड एनर्जी लेवल। सो इन केस ऑफ मेटल्स द फर्मी एनर्जी लेवल विल बी टॉप ऑफ द वैलेंस बैंड, क्योंकि वैलेंस बैंड कंप्लीटली अगर फिल्ड है तो हम बोलेंगे कि वहां तक पूरी के पूरे इलेक्ट्रॉन भरे हुए हैं। सो द टॉप ऑफ द वैलेंस बैंड इज योर फर्मी एनर्जी लेवल फॉर मेटल्स। बट इन केस ऑफ सेमीकंडक्टर्स और इंसुलेटर्स और इन जनरल द डेफिनेशन फ्रॉम स्टैटिस्टिकल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू इज डेफिनेशन ऑफ फर्मी लेवल इज फर्मी एनर्जी लेवल is energy level कुछ समझ में नहीं आया। सो इन सिंपल वर्ड इट रिप्रेजेंट्स द balance of number of electron and number of hole number of electron in valence band and conduction band। ye bhi nahi samajh mein hai। so this is my valence band and this is my conduction band। let's say at 0 degree kelvin all this valence band is filled and this conduction band is empty। so the probability of occupation of this valence band, top of the valence band fill up hai, to uska probability kya hoga 1, kyunki wo fill up hai, and conduction band puri tarah se empty hai, so iska probability kya hoga 0। so agar yahan pe probability 1 hai, yahan pe probability 0 hai, to half probability kahan pe hoga exactly halfway between this, so this will be my Fermi energy level। this is intrinsic semiconductor, correct? in case of extrinsic semiconductor, this is conduction band, this is valence band, and let's say I'm talking about n-type material, and let's also talk about p-type material। in case of n-type materials, now the donor impurity level will be closer to the conduction band, so this is donor impurity level, and in case of p-type material the acceptor impurity level will be closer to the valence band, so this is acceptor impurity level। and at 0 degree kelvin what is going to happen, at 0 degree kelvin the electron will be bound to the donor atoms in a case of n-type material, so the electron will be residing in this particular donor impurity level। similarly there will be holes residing at acceptor impurity level, right? now in this particular case, as we talked about this intrinsic semiconductor, since this highest top of the valence band is completely filled, hence the probability of occupation is 1, and since the bottom of the conduction band is totally empty, the probability of occupation is 0। so in this particular case, which level is completely filled? this donor level is completely filled, and hence the probability will be 1 for this particular level। and since the conduction band there are no electrons, so the probability will be 0। then where will be the probability is equal to half? Between this ED and this donor impurity level and conduction band. So in case of n-type material, this is the Fermi energy level. It is between donor impurity level and conduction band, right? Similarly, over here, since electrons are occupied in valence band in type, in case of p-type material, electrons are completely occupied in valence band. So the probability of occupation of top of the valence band will be 1. And since there are holes in acceptor impurity level, the probability over here will be 0. And hence, the probability of occupation equal to half will be exactly in between EA and valence band. So, the Fermi energy level will be over here. Please note, I am talking at 0 degree Kelvin. This is not at higher temperatures. This is for 0 degree Kelvin. Now, what is going to happen? When I go on increasing temperature, what's going to happen when temperature is increased? Let me redraw this particular diagram for intrinsic semiconductor, extrinsic semiconductor. So this will be the situation for intrinsic, n-type and p-type material at 0 degree Kelvin. Right? So this blue Fermi energy level is for 0 degree Kelvin. Now let's see what will happen when we go on increasing the temperature. When we go on increasing the temperature, electron make a transition from valence band into conduction band. So there will be hole over here and there will be electron over here. So the probability of occupation of this particular energy level decreases from 1, because there is a vacancy created, so it is not completely filled. So the probability of occupation of this particular thing, valence band, will be less than 1. Let's say it is 0.9, and the probability of occupation will increase. So yahan pe jitne se kam hoga utne se yahan pe probability badhega. Let's say it is 0.1. So what we have will be half, 0.5. again that will be exactly in between at the same level. So in case of intrinsic semiconductor, the Fermi energy level does not shift. However, let's look at what will happen in case of n-type material. When an electron make a transition from valence band to conduction band, right? Now, we have, as you go on increasing temperature, electron is making transition from valence band to conduction band, but before that, the occupied electron in donor impurity level, they also get transferred to conduction band, right? So now what we have is, we have probability of occupation is non-zero over here. Let's say it will be, let's say 0.3, and the probability of occupation of valence band will decrease because electrons are going into conduction band. So let's say it is 0.9. Now where will be 0.5? 0.5 will be somewhere here. So as you can see, the Fermi energy level has shifted as we go on increasing the temperature. As more and more number of electrons make a transition from valence band into conduction band, this Fermi energy level shifts further. And at elevated temperature, at very high temperature, EF will be at halfway between forbidden gap. What is forbidden gap? This band gap is also called as forbidden gap because no electron can reside in this particular gap. Okay. You understand this particular thing? Similarly, what is going to happen to the p-type material? Now, as we go on increasing the temperature, this electron from valence band will make a transition to the donor impurity level. Electron from valence band will make a transition to donor impurity level, and the hole available in donor impurity level will be occupied. Right? and some electrons will make a transition from valence band into conduction band. So there will be lots of hole over here. Now, which energy level have completely occupied? This energy level is completely occupied. So the probability of occupation of this will be equal to 1. The probability of occupation of this will be something non-zero number, because there are some number of electrons, and hence 0.5 will be in between these two energy levels somewhere here. So the Fermi energy level has shifted from in between Ea to and Vb towards the middle of the forbidden gap, and the same thing happens in the case of p-type material also. At elevated temperature, at very high temperature, Fermi energy level is halfway between the forbidden gap. And what's happened when the Fermi energy level goes is at a halfway between forbidden energy gap? It is a case of intrinsic semiconductor material. So in other words, at very large temperature, extrinsic semiconductor will start behaving as intrinsic semiconductor, and this is the reason why, this is one of the reason why there is temperature mentioned on every electronic device, because when temperature increases, extrinsic semiconductor behaves like an intrinsic semiconductor material, and because of that, the intended purpose of the device will not be served, because the intended purpose of a device depends on p-type and n-type character of a material. Okay, so you understand this particular thing, how this Fermi energy level make a transition. Now one more point, why I am not showing any electron in this Fermi energy level? This is because this is not an actual energy level. Fermi energy level is a fictitious energy level. Okay, so this red line is temperature greater than 0 degree Kelvin. Okay, so the Fermi energy level is not an actual energy level. This is the reference energy level, if you like to call it. Now, the last point that I want to discuss is, what will happen if I go on increasing the impurities? What is going to happen when concentration of impurity is increased? So, this is my Venn diagram. Let's say for n-type material, same thing will happen for p-type material as well, and this will be my donor impurity level, right? Now suppose this donor impurity level is shown in dotted line because there are few donor impurities as compared to the original silicon. We have replaced very few silicon atoms by impurity levels, and hence these donor atoms or impurity atoms will add their own energy levels, but it will not be throughout the material, right? Because if this is the case, suppose this is my crystal, since I am replacing a few atoms, so suppose this atom is replaced, so there will be an electron or impurity at this particular point. Another impurity will be at this particular point, so it is not continuous or very close, and hence we have showing this particular energy level in a dotted line. However, when we go on increasing the impurity concentration, what is going to happen? Here also there will be an impurity, here also there will be an impurity, and just like silicon, we have this impurity atoms, and just like when there are large number of atoms very close to each other, they start interacting and they form band. These impurity atoms will also start interacting with each other and they will form a band. So if I want to show concentration increase in this direction, this particular impurity energy level, as the concentration goes on, will start forming a band. And at very high concentration, this impurity band and conduction band will start overlapping. See, this is in this direction I am increasing, in this direction I am increasing concentration. So this is low concentration, this is high concentration. So at a very high concentration, they start overlapping, and when this donor impurity band and conduction band start overlapping, the material, the semiconductor material, is known as degenerate semiconductor. Why we call it as degenerate semiconductor? Because it start behaving as if it is a metal. What happens in metals? Metals, the valence band and conduction band, they overlap with each other. So in other words, a filled band and an empty band start overlapping. What about this donor band, impurity band? This impurity band is also filled and conduction band is empty at 0 degree Kelvin. So they start overlapping, and hence it behaves as if it is a metal, right? The same thing happens in case of P-type material as well. So this is conduction band, this is valence band, and I'm showing concentration increase in this particular direction. So initially the concentration will be very small, so I have impurity levels, and as concentration goes on increasing, this impurity level will start forming a band, and I have overlap of bands. And this is acceptor, so this is completely empty band, this is completely filled band, so this is something like a metal. So this is also, when they start overlapping, the impurity level and valence band start overlapping, it also forms what is known as degenerate semiconductor, right? So we discuss about what is going to happen to Fermi energy level, what is going to happen to impurity energy level when temperature increases, and when concentration increases. Okay, so Fermi energy level responds to temperature. So when you go on increasing temperature, with increasing temperature, the Fermi energy level will shift. So let me write over here. Fermi energy EF responds to temperature. However, there is not a huge effect on Fermi energy level because of concentration. There is an effect, but see, what is that effect? Instead of at the center of the band, this Fermi energy level is closer to the conduction band or valence band. That is the only difference. But with temperature, even if with the same concentration, it starts varying. Okay, so Fermi energy level responds to temperature. However, our impurity energy levels over here, they do not respond to temperature. They respond to concentration. So impurity energy level EA and ED, they respond to concentration. I hope you understand what is this semiconductor material and how we can write N-type and P-type material in terms of band diagram. In the next lecture, we will discuss about the first electronic device, that is diode. So in the next lecture, we are going to discuss about diode. And if you have any doubt, we can discuss your doubt also in that particular lecture. So thank you for your time. See you in the next video.